Ashley at Bookish Realm, and I'm back with another video. I am here to do my September mid-month wrap-up, which is super crazy. I have been mood reading like crazy this month, which is why I have been able to read so much, because I literally have just been picking up whatever I feel like picking up in the moment, and it has helped. So now I do definitely feel like my TBRs from now on are going to be super, super flexible, because seeing how this flexibility has really just improved my reading this month really makes me feel like, okay, well, I'm reading what I want to read, and I'm enjoying what I'm reading because I'm reading what I want to read. Therefore, at the end of the day, it seems like if I want my reading to continue like this, I need to create this level of freedom within myself and not constrict myself so much. So I have, as of today's date, which is the 17th, you all will not see this until the 19th, I have read 17 books so far. So we are going to try to make this video as concise as possible. This is super crazy. I don't think I've ever read this much at a mid-month point. And granted, a lot of these books are on the shorter side. Some of them are novellas, some of them are under 300 pages, but still, this is a little bit ridiculous. So we're gonna go ahead and jump in, because I have to get this filmed before I actually have a meeting in an hour. So this is gonna be absolutely fantabulous. So the first book that I read this month was A Song Erased in Ruins by Roseanne A. Brown, and this was the Patreon book club book pick for the month of August. So this is a YA 2020 debut fantasy release. It is about two main characters by the name of Malik and Karina, and it starts off with Malik trying to travel to Karina's city of Zaran, and she is the crown princess of Zaran, and he's traveling there for Stasia, I believe that's how you say it, and it is this major festival that happens, I believe, only once every 50 years. When they're traveling, Malik's sister ends up getting taken by this creature. I don't even want to delve into exactly what it is, because I feel like it's kind of on the spoiler side, and he has to cut a deal in order to save his sister. Now, on the other end of the book, we have our character Karina, who is a crown princess, and her mother is a sultana, and she ends up getting killed by an assassin. And when she gets killed by the assassin, of course, Karina attempts to figure out what exactly has happened, and she wants to bring her mother back from the dead. She finds this book that allows her to do so, and there are a set of criteria that she has to fulfill, namely being that she has to get the heart of a king. So she decides to hold the competition, marry someone as a prize, and then when she marries an individual, of course, she's going to end up taking their heart. For Malik's end of the story, he has to end up killing the crown princess in order to bring his sister back. So both of them are looking to kill each other in order to make their situations better. What I loved about this is that Brown really did challenge the dynamics of what we usually see as gender roles in traditional fantasy. I think it's changing a lot just in general, but in older fantasy, we see two distinct gender roles where our male character is very much so strong and is very protective, and our female character usually can play like a damsel in distress, but the roles are flipped, where Malik is much softer and Karina is so strong. She's very independent, very strong-willed, and I like that she flipped that trope and changed it up and did some really, really creative things with it. I liked the writing. I liked the magic system. There were twists and turns at the end of this book that I did not see coming whatsoever. I thought it was absolutely crazy. However, I only ended up giving this book a 3.75 stars because I had a couple of issues. One, namely, being the lack of disclosure in terms of the magic system. So I think that this book has a interesting magic system. I think it is very well thought, very well developed. However, I think readers spend a great portion of the beginning of this book being relatively confused, because there is no explanation of the world or the magic system. And I know that authors have to do that to some extent because sometimes magic systems and world building can play into the actual plot and it can cause spoilers. However, there was such a lack of clarity that I had no idea what was going on at some point because there was no clarity in how the magic system worked in this universe, and it made my read less enjoyable in the beginning. Once some things were revealed, I did really end up enjoying the book, but prior to that, it was just so hard to dig deep and enjoy it because I was like, well, how does this relate to the overall world and magic system at large? Another thing that I did not like is that there is this opportunity, and this is not a spoiler per se, I'm going to try to keep it as spoiler free as possible. There is this point where Karina does make it known that there have been queens who have married queens and that there are some instances where there's been some polyamory. There is a character in this book that does identify as a female and she's a part of this tournament, and what bothered me I think so much about that is that I feel like that was kind of a grazing of bisexual representation, but we knew it never was going to happen. And I know that this could have been a way to really just exhibit that the world wasn't confined to what we think of as quote-unquote traditional king and queendoms. However, I feel like it was thrown in such a lackadaisical way that I couldn't really define what the point was, and it felt tokenized. That's just my perspective. I know a lot of people don't necessarily have an issue with it, but it just felt like it was thrown in there for the sake of it being thrown in there, and I don't know. It just didn't sit right with me in my head. I know that some people were telling me that it was just to show that the world itself wasn't confined to traditional royalty standards, but it kind of ruined some aspects of the book because you knew at the end of the day that Karina needed a king's heart, so it didn't matter whether a woman was a part of that tournament or not, if that makes sense. I'm trying to say that without really saying exactly what happens, but overall, it was good writing. I am interested in picking up the second book in the duology, and I look forward to seeing what ends up happening to our main characters. I would also like to say that this book has trigger warnings for suicidal ideation, self-harm, anxiety representation, as well as emotional abuse by a parent. The next book was a random pick. I actually decided to try out Audible Escape just to try it out, and I found this book on Audible Escape called Him and Her by Shelby Mitchell. I ended up giving this book 3 stars. It is about two characters by the name of Micah and Nori, and Micah is this gamer, he's a game developer, and Nori is working in this grocery store as a chef, not really a chef. She's one of the individuals that assists with the meal prep for the hot bar, and when Micah tastes the food that she prepares, he instantaneously wants to hire her as his in-house chef, his personal chef. And it, of course, doesn't go over well with Nori because it was like, who is this white man attempting to get me to work in his house as if I'm the help type of situation? So they really hit it off nicely. I thought the chemistry between them was really, really cool. I think that they were super compatible. I think Micah definitely is an alpha male. He does have a very strong personality, so I know a lot of people are not going to necessarily like that. But I did find that they were a compatible couple. I like their banter. I like that Michael was really, really caring, especially when he found out some things about Nori and he was very, very concerned about her. However, my biggest hiccup with this book is when the two characters end up having sex, it is a very anatomical discussion, like literally the naming of specific body parts and the anatomy of Nori's body, especially in her genitalia, and it was very awkward. And I understand that what Mitchell was trying to do was illustrate the importance of knowing your partner and knowing how they should be pleased and knowing their bodies just as well as you know your own body. I understand that conversation. I think that's a very important conversation, but it was so technical that the sex scene felt sterile, and it felt like I was learning about sex in terms of a anatomy class or a biology class. It wasn't romantic. It wasn't hot. It was like, ew. I get that you want to prove that you are willing to learn her body. You want to understand how her body works. You want to understand what pleases her. But it was just too much. It was way, way too much. There also was a character that I have a love-hate relationship with, Colette, who apparently was a fling with Micah, and she inserts herself into the book a lot. She's a complete bitch. She is extremely rude to Nori, and she says some very fine line racist things to Nori. So it was me sitting listening to the book where I just wanted to throw hands. But yeah, she was just a nutcase. But like I said, I thought it was an okay book. I gave it 3 stars. This is the first book in a duology. However, I heard that these books are not written well in terms of editing. There are a lot of grammatical mistakes. So all of that stuff, I believe, was corrected before it was recorded on audio. But I heard that the actual ebook copies are not well written at all, and that the second book is just not good. So I am just probably gonna look at some spoilers for the second book just to find out what happens at the end of the book and where Micah and Nori's relationship ends up going. The next book that I read was Batman Superman Volume 1, and this is by Greg Pak and illustrated by Jay Lee. And this is issues 1 through 4, as well as Justice League 23.1 Darkseid, and I'll talk about that a little bit. So I did talk about this a little bit, I believe, in my final August wrap-up, where I talked about that I've been reading some DC comics, trying to catch up and read a good portion of DC New 52. Not that I really need to read DC New 52. I really should be focusing on Rebirth, but that's a completely different discussion for another day. And one of the parts that we're supposed to do before we really get into New 52 is look at how Batman and Superman meet before the New 52 universe. Now, this in itself, I gave it 3 stars because it is super confusing. It's super confusing if you have no knowledge of the DC multiverse, meaning that you don't know that there are multiple worlds that exist in the DC universe, and the worlds are mimics of just our traditional Earth. So in this one, we actually meet the DC New 52 Batman and Superman, and of course when they originally meet, they do not get along at all. Like, they don't get along at all. After we meet those two, we find out that there's this trickster goddess who attempts to take the two of them to Earth 2, which is a mimic of the New 52 Earth, and we meet an older version of Batman and Superman, and the young version, the New 52 Earth Batman and Superman, do not get along with the Earth 2 Batman and Superman. And what's so confusing about this especially is that you can't distinguish between the two Batmans and the two Supermans. They all look alike in the panel artwork. You don't know who is who. It's very difficult to figure out who's talking to who. I got them confused so easily. I would have to read panel after panel after panel over and over and over again just to try to differentiate between everyone, and I just couldn't. I also think that it gets kind of confusing because none of these characters know who Darkseid is. And this trickster goddess really does talk about Darkseid, and no one knows who Darkseid is. So it's just a whole confusing volume. I did love the flashback that happened in Earth 2 of when Batman and Superman of Earth 2 meet for the first time and how they've been like lifelong friends. I really, really love that because they have such a close relationship and it is the most adorable thing in the world. But I did not get down with not really understanding anything else that was going on. I did like the Justice League 23.1 Darkseid issue because we learn about the origins of Darkseid, who I heard is one of the best DC villains out there. I definitely am going to have to keep reading to figure out what exactly happens with Justice League in terms of Darkseid, because I'm not as familiar with him as a villain, but I think it's going to be really, really fun and really, really interesting. But this would have been a great volume for me to read before I read Justice League Volume 1 Origins, because it shows why Batman and Superman in that first volume do not get along. They already just had some tension between them, and all that tension really starts with this Batman Superman Volume 1. The next thing that I ended up reading was That Could Be Enough by Alyssa Cole, and this is a sapphic romance that is not necessarily a retelling of Hamilton, but it takes place in post-Revolutionary War era US, and we have Eliza Hamilton present as a secondary character in the book. It really heavily focuses on the relationship between Mercy and Andromeda. Actually, Mercy works as a maid slash assistant. She just really works around the Hamilton house and works with the family and really does a lot for Eliza Hamilton. And when this novella takes place, Eliza is actually writing some memoir of her own, I believe, or getting documentation of those that had served with Hamilton during the Revolutionary War. So she actually is interviewing Andromeda, because Andromeda is coming on behalf of her grandfather Elijah, which is super crazy because Elijah is actually the main character in Be Not Afraid, which is another historical romance novella by Alyssa Cole. So it was really interesting for me to hear about Andromeda and realize that Elijah was actually this Elijah. So when Andromeda and Mercy meet, of course, Mercy instantaneously has an attraction for her. She really likes some things about Andromeda, but she keeps denying herself the ability to like Andromeda. And I really like the relationship between them because Andromeda helps open up Mercy and helps break down her walls, because Mercy has been hurt a lot in the past. And Andromeda breaks down those walls that she has, and they allow themselves to feel for each other. I think that what's amazing about this historical romance is that it does address the fact that during this time, Black people would have faced discrimination. We see that with some instances and some things that happened with Andromeda. However, Alyssa Cole creates this bubble in which we allow our characters to feel joy and to flourish outside of the racism and misogyny that they may have been experiencing during that time. So it is addressed, but it's not the main focus. She gives her characters Black joy and Black happiness, and I really appreciated that. Of course, the writing was lyrical, it was sensual, I really enjoyed it, and I ended up giving this one 4 out of 5 stars. The next book that I read was The Boyfriend Project by Farah Roshan, and this is a contemporary romance, but I've been looking at some reviews that say that this also falls on the end of women's fiction, which explains why some people may not get the feel that they're expecting when they're reading it. I'm still learning the difference between romance and women's fiction, so do not 100% quote me on that. So this book actually happens in a fun and interesting way. The premise is really, really cool, but really, really heartbreaking at the same time. So we have three women by the name of London Taylor and Samaya, and they all have been dating the same man, and they don't realize that they have been dating the same man until something happens. They all figure it out, and then they all decide to become friends and to pick up projects, passion projects, and to work on themselves for 6 months. So, of course, what ends up happening is that Samaya decides that she actually is going to work on this dating app that she's been meaning to work on for the longest time. And then she meets this guy at work by the name of Daniel, and things ensue, romance happens. Of course, there's a huge fallout. What I loved about this book, especially two specific things. One, I love the relationship dynamic between the women. I love that you have three women of color working together to find themselves, to uplift each other, to encourage each other. I really, really love that. I also loved that there was this constant discussion of the importance of having women of color in the tech industry. I think that the other book that I read this year that does the same type of thing is The Right Swipe by Alicia Rye. This has that same conversation about women in color being a part of the tech industry, and we really get to see what that experience is like through Samaya's eyes and how she's had to put up her guard on certain things and not trust people in her industry because people try to steamroll her because she's a Black woman serving in this high-tech company. And I really like that. But it fell short for me in terms of the romance. I think that if the author would have taken a little bit more time to space out when Samaya met Daniel, it probably would have made a little bit more sense to me, because Samaya makes this deal with London and Taylor, the 6-month deal. And a week after this whole thing explodes with the guy that they were all dating, she ends up meeting Daniel. So for me, it was like, dang, you made this commitment 6 months to building yourself, and then a week later, you meet somebody. I know you can't help when you meet somebody in real life. However, I think if this was about developing ourselves, being comfortable in ourselves and working on passion projects, I think that if it would have been a situation where, like, after a month or 2 months, she ended up meeting Daniel, it would have worked better for me. But because it happened within like a week, I was just like, yikes, that's too soon. Because in everything that she had built and established with the other two ladies just kind of went out the window, and she was very much so just focused on her romance with Daniel. And on top of that, Daniel did something in the last 20% of the book that really just rubbed me the wrong way, that would have personally for me broken all levels of trust. And I think that Samaya was quick to forgive him. It was a violation of privacy and space, and I don't know if it was realistic for her to get over it in that way so quickly. So this wasn't a bad book. It wasn't a bad book at all, but there were just technical things about it that could have been done better, and it could have been paced better, but the writing was excellent. I did like the characters, and I ended up giving this one 3.5 stars. The next book that I ended up reading was Fire We Make by Ava Freeman. This is book 2 in the After Hours series. Remember that these books don't have to be read in order. They are only connected by theme, not necessarily by characters. I didn't see any crossovers between the first book and this book. And these are sapphic romances. They usually take place in a workplace environment. I talked about this a little bit in my Black Indie Romance recommendations video. And this is specifically focused on two characters by the name of Kenya and Sydney. Kenya is a lawyer in this firm. She is quickly making her way to the top. She's powerful, but she hasn't been in a relationship in a while. And then she meets this woman by the name of Sydney, and Sydney is actually a high level worker in the tech industry. I don't know what exactly her position is, but she does a lot of computer troubleshooting, and she's at a high level in her profession. And that was one of the big things that I loved about this book, not only just the romance, but the fact that we had two strong Black women working in two powerful positions. I love that. I love that. I thought it was just, that alone was hot, to see like two Black women making power moves was just so attractive. So we have these two women. They of course have this instantaneous attraction. They get along so well. They make things work so well. And I know that there were some hiccups along the way in terms of how things happen and building their relationships, but it felt so natural that it didn't feel like a hiccup. It wasn't this huge thing where it was like, oh my gosh, I can't believe this happened, and now they're questioning whether they should get back together or not. Things happened, things went wrong, but it was, seems like it was just such a natural part of their relationship, so it just felt like, okay, yeah, I could see that happening. And then the pacing was done very, very well, so we could see their romance build and build. And then what Ava Freeman does very well is that she spaces things out so that we get these chunks of time that pass by, even though we're reading a novella. That way we can have this realistic development of a relationship without having to suspend so much disbelief at the time frame in which they possibly could build a relationship. It was just so good. I really enjoyed the series. I am looking to hopefully finish out the series by the end of the month. Like I said in my Black Indie Romance recommendations video, if you're looking for a well-developed sapphic romance series written by a Black author featuring strong Black female characters, I definitely would recommend picking up this series. And I ended up giving this book 4 out of 5 stars. The next book that I ended up reading was In the Doctor's Bed, and this is by Brenda Jackson. This is the first book in the Hopewell General Hospital series. There's 4 books, but they're all written by different authors. But I tried this first one out that was written by Brenda Jackson. This is my first Brenda Jackson book. And this is about 2 characters by the name of Lucien and Jacqueline. And Lucien is actually a resident at Hopewell General, and Jacqueline is a intern at Hopewell General. And the two have this attraction to each other, but of course, because of workplace protocol, there's no fraternization, they can't really get into relationships, so they kind of have to sneak around. This definitely had a lot of Grey's Anatomy vibes to it, but I actually like the relationship between Lucien and Jacqueline better than the one between Meredith and Derek. However, the part of this book that I didn't enjoy was the fact that there wasn't much that happened with the plot. So we know that the two are not supposed to fraternize, they're not supposed to be together, and they start sneaking around, and it just becomes a cyclical thing where nothing really happens. And then there was something that happens at the very end of the book, but it felt like it was kind of just thrown in for the sake of throwing it into the plot to make something happen, and it didn't work. But I do love the way that Lucien treats Jacqueline. He will whisk her away on these great adventures, and he's not doing this as a means to hide Jacqueline from people because he's ashamed of her, but because he values her and doesn't want her to lose her job. And he's very strict about not putting anybody in front or in the way of his career development, but he really cares about her so much that this is the person that he really, really wants to be with. So the chemistry between them was good. It's just that nothing really happens, so it becomes repetitive in some ways. And I ended up giving this one 3.5 stars. The next book that I read was Fans Only by B. Love. I love, 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 love this book. This is one of her newer releases. And this is about 2 characters by the name of Merrick and Aries. And they have grown up together. They have been friends for a while. They actually are having this discussion with their friends about the Fans Only camera and account and the sex industry, and would they ever actually do something of the sort. And then they actually have the conversation, just Merrick and Aries, about the fact that they would be willing to do it with each other as friends, because of the fact that she wants to eventually go and train under this big fashion designer and actually be able to create her own fashion house. And in order to do that, she would need to train under this designer, and she needs the money for it. And then of course with Merrick, he wants to have his own recording studio and company and stuff, and his own line of music, and becoming a producer, the whole nine. And they make this agreement that they're going to do it for an X amount of time, and then once they reach their financial goals, they're going to stop doing it. Of course, you can't have 2 friends make a Fans Only account where they are consistently having sex with each other and no one gets feelings. So they made this pact that they were not going to catch feelings for each other, because they would not take it any steps further. And off the bat, it was this instantaneous attraction between the two of them, and Merrick treated her like a queen, even when he was at the point where he was like, we can't catch feelings, we can't go past this, we just need to be focused on what we're doing and focus on our work, because we both just don't have the means and capacity to be in relationships right now. He treated her like a queen. Merrick was just in denial with his feelings. That's all that was. He was in straight denial of his feelings, because he was willing to make her so comfortable. Like, they were just friends, but Merrick was like, I know that we're friends, but at the end of the day, you're having sex with me. You are sharing your body with me. I want you to be comfortable. I want to set the mood right so you feel comfortable doing this. I want to make sure that I take care of you, whether I am, you know, paying for you to look the part or whatever the case may be. I just want you to feel okay doing that. And I absolutely love that. I really love that Merrick was out to prove Aries wrong, in the sense that Aries has issues with relationships because she falls in love with the idea of the perfect man and not really taking things for what they are at face value. And I think that Merrick wanted to show her that there are people out there that can be good, not just the idea of them being good, but they're actually good people. And she needed that. She needed that trust. She needed to see that. She needed to feel that. And this book made me swoon. They were just perfect for each other. This book, of course, does have use of strong language, strong explicit sex on page, because it is about making a fan cam, and we see them have lots and lots and lots of sex. So it didn't bother me at all, but if that's gonna bother you, I would say just keep that in mind. There is a plot to it. Like, there is character development. There is a plot. It isn't just page after page after page of them having sex. But there is more than one sex scene that you may see in a, like, traditional published romance book. And of course, I ended up giving that one 5 out of 5 stars. Sorry, y'all, if the camera angle has changed. As you know, in the meeting, I said that I was filming this prior to meeting. So I just got out of a 2.5 hour meeting. So I don't remember exactly how I was positioned, but I'm sure that the camera angle has changed, but that is okay. We're just gonna jump right back in and talk books. The next book that I ended up reading was an advance reader copy that was sent to me by Penguin Teen. And this is part of their pocket collection books that they've been doing. It was the same series that I read last month with Beyond the Gender Binary, and this one is Concrete Kids by Amira Leon, and this one is written in a free verse. It is an ode to all kids kissed by melanin or black and brown kids. And Amira weaves so many different elements of her personal life and what it's like to grow up and be black and brown and be part of certain communities. And it really is about pushing people's dreams forward, especially these kids, because what I got from reading it is that sometimes it's hard to dream outside of the boundaries that your community has created when a lot of these kids end up staying within the same 2 to 3 block radius their entire life. Amira touches on so many different things: self-love, the HIV/AIDS epidemic, the cyclical trauma that occurs when you see violence happen so much. And it is a way to uplift and to recognize the dreams and the goals of some of these kids that are in these communities. And she even laces in her experience growing up in foster care, her experience of abuse at the hands of those that were supposed to be taking care of her until she gets the opportunity to live with someone else and live in Brooklyn. It was so beautiful. I found myself reading passages over and over and over again, not because I didn't understand it, but I wanted to make sure that I was grasping every little thing that she was saying. So it is a mix of free verse and prose, and it's so beautiful. There's so many references to so many different things. Like, at one point I was surprised to find that there was a reference to Lil Mama's song Lip Gloss. I hadn't heard that song in years, and when I read the lyrics I was like, I know that song. And I realized what it was, and I ended up googling it and listening to the song and took me down memory lane. There were references to the song Strange Fruit, which is a very, very heavy song if you've never heard of it, by Billie Holiday. Very, very tough song, but very, very important song. It's in reference to lynching. And she interweaves so many different elements from her own personal life, her own personal experiences, and really becomes this voice for individuals that experience some of the things that she's experienced or things that she's seen. And I think that Penguin has something really good going on here with these pocket change collections, because they're giving us insights to a lot of things that communities in this country are facing and that we need to be more aware of. I definitely ended up giving this one 5 stars as well. I really want to check out more of the pocket change collections, because these have definitely been a hit. They've been a hit, and this is the second one that I've read. The next book that I ended up reading was the first book in this new series by Ashley Woodfolk called The Fly Girls, and this one is called Lux, The New Girl. So this is a series of 4 books, I think, that's gonna be, that Ashley Woodfolk has written, and these are considered high-low books. So if you read this book, you may find that the actual writing of the book is a little bit more on the simplistic side, and that's intentional. So I have been seeing some reviews where people have talked about the writing, and it's not It's not that she didn't know what she was doing. It's intentional. It's considered a high-low book, which is discussed a lot in the publishing industry, what we talk about a lot in libraries. High-low books are books that are written with high interest but low difficulty. These books are great for those who are reluctant readers. They're also great for kids that are not reading on grade level. So when you have, for instance, a high school kid come in and they're only reading on a sixth grade reading level, but it would be kind of crazy looking to them for them to go to the kids section and get a book on their grade level, they still want to be able to read materials that A, they can relate to, and B, they're not embarrassed to hold or have in front of friends or family. So there are these books called high-low books that help with situations like that, where they are high interest, they would meet the criteria that their audience is looking for, but they're low difficulty and can help with those two elements. So I'm glad that she decided to do this. I think it's going to be a very interesting series. These books seem to really fall along the line of like the Bluford High series. I don't know if anyone has heard of those. Those are kind of classic books that we often use specifically at my location in the library system. But this one is about a young girl by the name of Lux. And Lux has some anger management issues after her father and her mother separate. She gets into a lot of fights. She's been expelled from about three or four different schools. She gets into her final fight and she gets expelled, and at that point her mom is like, I'm done, you need to move to your father's house and live with him. And she does that. She ends up going to this art school and she meets three other girls who are considered the fly girls, and she wants to fit in with them. I thought it was really interesting seeing that dynamic and seeing Lux having to make new friends and trying to create a new image for herself, because she didn't want to be known as the kid who got kicked out of school for fighting. And she looked to these three girls to help her fit that image, and I thought that that was a really interesting concept. My huge criticism of this, because I found it really, really intriguing and it was an extremely quick read, I wish that Asha Woodfolk would have touched a little bit more on the mental health aspect of this book, because I think that Lux definitely had some issues in terms of anger management, and I think it would have been nice to see on page her speaking to someone that specialized in how to deal with anger management and how to deal with parental loss, especially in the sense that her father had moved away and started a completely different life with a new wife and a new child, and that can create a very troubling dynamic for kids, and a lot of kids go through that. And I know that the discussion around mental health in the Black community is getting better, but I think that seeing that on page in a book like this would have been really, really great. But other than that, I really enjoyed it. Like I said, it was fast-paced, it was quick. I really like the character development. I like the relationship between the four girls. There's a lot of diversity that's in this book, and I'm excited to see where the series is going to go. I think I probably have already said it, but if I didn't, I gave it 4 stars. The next book that I ended up reading was Janine Frost's book Halfway to the Grave, which is the first book in the Night Huntress series. I have had such a horrible experience reading vampire books because I was reading the Twilight Saga as well as Midnight Sun, and I just was like, you know what, I'm gonna try something different in terms of paranormal and vampires, and I'm gonna try paranormal romance. And I know that this one is extremely popular. A lot of people have said that they really enjoyed it, and I was like, I don't know, because I was listening to it, and I think probably like the first 10 to 15%, I was like, this main character Kat is just annoying, I'm not sure whether I'm gonna like her. But then when you have the other main character Bones enter into the situation, I really just started to like their dynamic and their banter and everything. But I'm gonna go back and really talk about what the series is about before I start doing character analysis. But Halfway to the Grave is about a main character by the name of Kat, who is actually half a vampire, and there's some situations that happen with her mom in reference to a vampire, and now she is half a vampire. She spends her nights hunting vampires who are not aware of the fact that she herself is a half vampire because she doesn't like them. She feels like all they do is force themselves on women and that they're out to just kill people. So she has that line of thinking until she comes across Bones, who is a vampire, but a bounty hunter type of vampire, and he specifically looks for vampires and is trying to account for some of the things that they have done. I'm trying to be as vague as possible because his bounty hunting has a lot to do with the plot itself. And they end up joining forces. Of course, this is a paranormal romance, so there is an attraction between the two of them, and I love them together as a couple. They are super balanced. So Kat, to me, is very high strung. She'd be very annoying, very naive, very young in thought process. But Bones, of course, he is older, and not just in the fact that older in the sense of human years, but he's older as a vampire, and he just has a more subtle and calm personality, and they balance each other very, very well. And I really enjoyed that dynamic between the two of them. I thought they worked very, very well together. I think that Bones really helped build up not only just like the self-esteem that Kat had, but also just build her up just as a person, and knowing that he cares about her. He helps her deal with some familial issues, and they're great. And the plot was so crazy. So it takes a little while for things to build up, but once it builds up, you really do get some interesting things that go on. There was some vampire lore that I wasn't really aware of that happens in this book. There are some aspects of it that are a tad bit dated. I mean, I think that this was written in 2009, so we're talking 10 years later. So there are some aspects that may be a little like, you know, I don't know if this would necessarily work in 2020, but for the most part, like, it was just really, really well written, very good plot. The conclusion had my mind blown so much that I went and bought the novella from Kindle, as well as the second book on audio through my library. So I'm excited to keep diving into the series. I'm looking forward to seeing what else happens between these two. I know that there's even a spinoff series, but the way that that ending happened, I did not see that coming. The person that they were looking for was not the person that I thought it was going to be. But yes, if you've never heard of the series, which I think most people have, but if you've never tried it, definitely think about picking it up in October. This book definitely has trigger warnings for rape that is described on page, sexual assault, drug use, date raping, explicit sex on page, and graphic violence. So the next book that I ended up reading was Flow, which was the prequel novel to the Grip series. And this takes place, I believe, 8 years before the events of Grip. And it's about two characters by the name of Marlon and Bristol. And Marlon is actually, his name is Grip, his stage name is Grip, and he's a rapper. And he meets Bristol when Bristol comes to town to visit her twin brother, who she's been kind of estranged from because he emancipated himself from their parents, and she's come to make amends and to repair the relationship. And instead of that happening, she ends up spending a lot of time with Marlon because of her brother's work schedule. And I thought that this was really interesting. This is an interracial romance, and what I love that Kennedy Ryan did was have these important discussions about race and culture and just societal expectations, especially coming from people from two different backgrounds. There's this heavy discussion about the use of the N-word, and I'm not gonna lie to you, when Bristol first made her points in the book, she kind of rubbed me the wrong way, because I have this thing about how the Black community discusses the use of the N-word, and it's always interesting when a non-Black person jumps in to give their opinion about how it should and should not be used. And I think that Marlon really brought in an important piece of the puzzle in terms of understanding its usage and explaining that to Bristol, and why he would or would not use the word, and why others may or may not use the word. And there was this whole discussion of the Black community not being a monolith and not being able to speak for everybody. It was nice to see that conversation happen and to see them talk about some real life issues. And Bristol and I just have some personality compatibility issues. I am not the biggest fan. It's not that I dislike her, but I'm not Bristol's number one fan. So that was kind of an issue for me. But I do like the fact that these two characters got to know each other. You could tell that they had a lot of chemistry. I was very, I don't want to say upset, but I felt like Marlon could have avoided the entire situation that happens at the end of this book had he just opened up his mouth, because you can see his internal dialogue where he was attempting to figure out what exactly he should have done in terms of communicating about certain aspects of his life to Bristol, and he didn't handle things the way he should have handled things, and it caused a huge problem that could have technically been avoided. And communication tropes are very, very tricky for me. I can get down with them if they're done very, very well. Sometimes they're not done as well, and this is one of those situations where I was like, I think that could have been avoided. I understand why it was done, but and the way that it was done left for the biggest cliffhanger in the world at the end of this book. But I just feel like maybe if he just would have been open and honest and just communicate it. So it's just one of those type of situations. But I think that the characters had a great romance. This is a novella, so not a lot happens, but I was okay with that, strangely. I know I'm very big on like nothing happens, but in this one it was more so about character development and the characters getting to know each other, and I appreciated that and I respected that because it felt like this was going to be the build up to the first book, which is super important in laying the groundwork as to why Bristol and Marlon may function the way that they do in the first book, knowing that they had this backstory. So I think by this just being a way to see how their relationship started, how they get along, their compatibility, really, really laid the groundwork for my expectations in the first book. And I ended up giving this one 4 out of 5 stars. So the next book that I ended up reading is the same book, and it is called The Sisters of APF. I'm not going to say the full title because I don't want this video to get a strike. I think I've already cursed once in this video, but this would be pushing it to the limit. And I do feel like I knew what I was getting myself into because I've heard about Zane before, and that her books can get wild as far as sexual content, which doesn't bother me. It was my expectation, but there was a certain element of this book that I couldn't get past, but we'll talk about that after I kind of describe what the book is about. So the Sisters of APF, and I don't know what's going on with my voice, are a group of women that are all about sexual liberation and being able to find your sexual gratification as a woman, especially when society sets forth these standards that women are only having sex for the pleasure of the man and not for the woman. And this is talking about specifically in a cisgender heterosexual relationship. I was really interested in looking at this sexual liberation, this conversation about women being able to have sex and not have to live in this double standard of we can't have sex and enjoy it the way that other people can because we need to be chaste type of situation. And I thought I was getting that because it focuses on a girl by the name of Mary Ann, who's from South Dakota. She has been in a sexual relationship before. She's had a partner before, and then she ends up moving to DC to go to law school, and she meets Olive and Patricia, who are members of APF, which she doesn't know at the time of meeting them. You do find that out early. It's not a spoiler because the book is actually told from all three of their perspectives. And it's interesting seeing her transition from becoming this individual that was very of the mind and thought process that sex was for the enjoyment of your male counterpart and not for yourself. And of course, she transitions outside of that. My hugest issue with this book is that it glorified cheating, and I just can't promote or accept things like that. I know that cheating does happen. I've read romance books where there has been a cheating element, and it does make me cringe because I always feel like cheating not only destroys relationships with the two people involved, but it does harm people who are on the outside as far as collateral damage is concerned, it can really destroy the mental and emotional health of individuals, and also the physical health. Everything is just interconnected there. So it's such a fine line, and it's such a tricky thing to include in the books if it's not done in a certain way. And this book definitely just did not do that at all. So we actually have characters who are serial cheaters. We have characters who cheat because their partner has cheated, and we have characters who cheat because they feel like if men cheat, then why can't we? And I just couldn't get past that. I just felt like that was just a line that I just couldn't get over, because there was one specific point where a character tries to teach her partner how to satisfy her sexually. He agrees, he listens, and he does so. She's satisfied, and she still decides to cheat. And I just can't for the life of me figure out why that is even remotely okay. It's different if you're in a partnership with someone and you feel like, you know what, we want to bring other people into our relationship, whether we want this to be a one-time thing or whether we want to make this a polyamorous relationship. If that's a conversation and agreement that happens between partners, that's a completely different thing. But in this book, it wasn't an agreement of polyamorous relationships. It was just, I have a significant other, I have a partner, but they are not fulfilling me and my sexual desires, so I'm going to cheat on them. But I'm still going to keep them for other things like my emotional desires, my financial desires, my mental desires. It was horrible. And for the life of me, I don't know if it was just my inability to not finish, hoping that maybe it would get better, maybe there would be more explanation. And I think that's what I was looking for. I was looking for more explanation and justification as to why these women in this book were seeking sexual gratification, but were doing it while being in committed, what was supposed to be committed, monogamous relationships. And I was so about the sexual gratification. I was so about having the conversation of women being able to please themselves or please themselves with a partner, however you want to throw people in the mix. I'm all about that. Those conversations, I think, are extremely important. But the cheating justification was just not working for me. I don't think that is ever a time in which you can justify cheating by saying like, oh, they're not fulfilling my sexual desires, so I'm gonna cheat. Like, that destroys relationships, and none of these partners were aware. So, and then there was this issue of a character getting upset because her boyfriend cheated and then was holding him to this high standard, but she was cheating the entire time, that she was telling him that he was no good for cheating. It just was super unhealthy, and it just didn't make any sense. So I ended up giving this one 2 out of 5 stars, which the only reason why I got 2 instead of 1 was because the conversations that happened amongst the women in terms of setting your financial goals and making investments and working together and uplifting each other and saying that women deserve to have sexual gratification just as much as men, I was down for all of that. It was the cheating that I just could not get past. The next book that I ended up completing is actually a comic book, and this is The Wicked and the Divine, The False Act. This is volume 1 of the Wicked and the Divine series, and this was my 3rd time reading this book, and I just wanted to show you all some of the artwork. I'm always looking for a page that doesn't spoil y'all, because spoiling you was just not my thing. But that's some of the artwork. The artwork in this is absolutely beautiful. And if you read a lot of the reviews, people say that they got this solely for the artwork, but they didn't understand what's going on. I want to explain why you may not understand what's going on in some parts of this book. But there goes another panel of artwork. So The Wicked and Divine is about these gods and goddesses who essentially like reincarnate themselves into human beings that are already on Earth every 90 years, and then they live for 2 years and then they die and go dormant again. So when we enter into The Wicked and Divine, we are in the series of time in which the gods and goddesses are alive, and I think they have most of their time left at the beginning of this book. So it follows a character by the name of Laura. Laura goes to college, but she's obsessed with finding these gods and goddesses, and they actually become pop star icons, and people want to get to know them, people want to be close to them, people want power just like them. And Laura is one of those people. She wants a slice of the pie, she wants to be in the mix. And she actually does end up getting in the mix more than what she thought, and her expectations are completely thrown to the side when she figures out exactly what these gods and goddesses are like on the inside. And she meets Lucy, who is supposed to be, I think, Lucifer essentially. And Lucy is talking to her after Laura meets this, after Laura attends this concert. And what ends up happening is that two humans end up dead, and people think that it was Lucy who did it, and she ends up going to jail. So it's Laura, and also I believe the other character's name is Cassandra. I believe that's her name. They end up having to figure out exactly who truly killed these humans, and if it was another god or goddess that was harnessing similar powers to Lucy, or if Lucy really did it, because, I mean, it would make sense for Lucy to lie about it. But there's so much more to this book, and I will say that it will help you understand the plot of this comic book series if you research who the gods and goddesses are. They pull so many gods and goddesses from so many different cultures and religions and time periods that you're gonna probably have to do a little bit of research, because they act in ways that are specific to what god and goddess they represent. So there is a goddess in here specifically who embodies multiple people, and the reason why she switches people so much in this first bind up is because of the fact that the actual goddess that it is based off of embodied more than one individual. So that's why I think it's important that these writers and artists have laid the groundwork, but you still have to make the leap and the jump to kind of Google, okay, like, well, who's this god or goddess, and what do they actually stand for? So that's actually why I have these purple tabs, because there were some gods and goddesses that I was not familiar with, and they come from so many different backgrounds. I was really interested. Like, there's one in here that is based off of Irish mythology, one in here that is based off of Japanese mythology. There's so many. There's one that is based off of Canaanite and ancient Mesopotamian religions. So it's a lot, and it explains why they behave the way that they do. This is super fast paced. It takes you on a heck of a ride. And the last, I think, like, three panels of this, the last six panels of this, leave you on such a cliffhanger that if you do decide to read this, I highly suggest having at least the next two volumes to read. Make sure they're available, because you're going to want to know why things happen the way that they happen at the end. And I ended up giving this one 4 out of 5 stars. Next, I ended up finishing The Coldest Winter Ever by Sister Solja. By the time that this goes up, we will be having a live show discussion the next day at 8:30 p.m. EDT. I actually should put that flyer up today. But this is a classic book to the Black community. I think so many people in the Black community have heard of this book. They've read this book. They were probably reading this book when they shouldn't have been reading this book. But this is about a character by the name of Winter Santiago, and she is the princess of her she's the princess of her block, in the sense that her father is this huge drug dealer in her area and broader area, and he provides her with this lavish lifestyle, her other three sisters and her mom. And this book is difficult in the sense that Winter is not a likable character. Winter is a character that you're going to hate. Winter is a character that you're going to look at and you're going to be like, how many stupid decisions can you make? It is intentional. Sister Solja wrote this book to use Winter as an example of cycles that we perpetuate on our kids and our kids' kids. So Winter ends up in a situation where she has to start from scratch, because of course, with her dad being in this huge system of drugs, there's only but so much time before you get taken down. That's just the nature of the beast. And she is not prepared for the real world. She is stuck on living her lavish lifestyle and being that HBIC and having the latest Dolce & Gabbana, or, you know, having the flyest accessories, having the flyest whip, and making sure that she always looks good and that she's always on point. But she makes some really stupid and immature decisions, and it's because she's been raised in this cycle of having wealth and beauty at the forefront and not having any sense, no knowledge, no street smarts. And you see her pay a hefty price for that. Sister Soldier actually does write herself into the book to try to be a voice and a light to Winter and to teach her this is what we need to stop doing in the Black community. We need to be able to communicate. We need to be able to help each other build. We need to make investments as a community so that we have things that we can pass on to our children besides these horrible habits of, you know, getting quick rich and being a part of this drug industry that's going on. And of course, I won't specifically tell you what happens with Winter, but it does make you question at the end whether Winter really learned her lesson or not. Sister Soldier covers everything in here from drug use to drug dealing to HIV and AIDS to rape to violence. It's just, it's so much stuff that is covered in this book. And it's not always an easy read. There are some graphic things that happen on page. There are discussions about the prison system and raping in the prison system that were definitely hard to read on page, but it is such an important book to the Black community because these are real struggles that the Black community faces. I think it was just really interesting to see things through Winter's perspective and see the ignorance in which she lived, because ignorance for her was bliss. And knowing that she needed to make a way to survive, and she couldn't make a way to survive because she was concerned about the wrong things. And it's almost like a cautionary tale for the Black community. If we don't change our ways, we will all end up being Winter Santiago. If we don't change our mindsets and we don't think about what we could be doing to benefit the entire community. So this is a classic. We will be continuing to read the series, and they're more like companion novels. The next one is A Deeper Love Inside, which is Portia Santiago's story, which is Winter's sister. And then there are three books about Midnight, who is more so of a secondary character in this book. We see him quite a bit, but not as much as I would like to, but he has his own trilogy. So, and it's good that I reread this because actually Sister Soldier is writing the true sequel to The Coldest Winter Ever, and that's set to come out March of 2021, and I ended up giving this one 4 stars. After that, I ended up reading The Promised Neverland, and this is by Kayu Shirai. I'm saying that completely wrong. I know that I am. And this is about a group of kids that live in this home with their mother, who is taking care of all of it. It's like 30 something kids that she's taking care of. And they have fun. They get great food. They get along with each other. They have outdoor time. They have school time, and they take these tests, and she's just very loving and caring, and they have some rules. So what's really interesting is that they are not supposed to go to the gate that's on the property, and they're not supposed to cross the fence that's on the perimeter of the forest. I was like, oh, okay, this is probably like some post-apocalyptic type of thing. Who knows? I was so wrong. Holy crap. I did not know what this book truly was about until I read it, and then I got past like the first chapter and I was like, you've got to be kidding me. Holy crap. It took a twist that I could have never in a million years see coming. Never in a million years could I have seen this coming. And this whole manga is full with twists and turns. It's so crazy. It is probably one of the best manga that I've read in a little while. You guys know that I do read manga. I've been trying to try out new manga, and somebody either on Twitter or on the community board here recommended that I try The Promised Neverland, and I thank you for blessing me with the series, because I went and put volumes on hold at the library. I wish I would have had that prepared prior to reading this, because now I'm like, I just want to binge the series, whatever is available. So this was great. I don't even want to tell you more about it. Just know that it was fascinating, and that I loved it, and that I got on Twitter last night and I was like, what did I just read? What am I reading? This is so great. I haven't even marked it as read on Goodreads yet, but I definitely would give this a 5 out of 5 stars. It was so good. It was so freaking good, and I cannot wait to dive into the rest of the series. And the last thing that I read for this mid-month, which is probably the longest mid-month wrap-up that I've done yet, is When No One Is Watching by Alyssa Cole, which is her new thriller that she put out. This is my second Alyssa Cole book for the month. And wow. So this, for me, and I think a lot of people have said this already, that this definitely reads more as a horror than a thriller. I think that her marketing team or the publisher should have really reconsidered labeling this as a thriller. I know that she calls it a thriller as well. It just reads better as a horror. And there are a couple reasons why I want to say that, but I don't want to spoil certain elements of it. It reads like it should be like Get Out. So Get Out is horror with like thriller elements to it. And it explains a lot why things are done. Like, I know a lot of people have issues with the pacing. And I know like Maura at Books Like Woe and Bethany over at A Beautifully Bookish Bethany both have said, if you look at it as reading horror, the pacing thing is not as troublesome. And I would have to agree with that. I would also like to add, I wonder if the pacing also happened the way that it happened because she was trying to write it as if this is exactly what happens when you go through the process of gentrification, where it seems like nothing is happening at first and it's just these really small subtle changes. And I'm only saying this because I'm actually watching a neighborhood get gentrified right now in a community that I'm working in, and it's very subtle. You don't really notice what's going on because it's a very, very slow process. You see maybe like one or two properties disappear and then they start building and you don't really know what's going on. They're building these new communities, these nice apartment complexes and condos, and you're not really thinking about it. And then all of a sudden, next thing you know, the entire neighborhood has been gentrified. And I wonder if that's what she was trying to do, was show that slow process, like it literally feels like it's nothing and all of a sudden everything happens at once. And if so, I definitely get that. I definitely do get that. I'm not saying that gentrification is always like that, but I've seen it be a slow process and then it just explodes and everything just seems like it's happening all at once. But this was definitely well written. It made me itch so bad in certain scenes. There were certain things that our main character was describing and it literally made my skin crawl. I was listening to it somewhere in these past couple days. I don't even know if I was here listening to it or if I was actually at work. I think I was at work listening to it. Yes, I was at work listening to it, and there was something that I'm itching now, that the author was describing or the main character was describing, and it literally just made my skin crawl. Just the visual, it was disgusting. And I'm mind blown that she has such versatility. Alyssa Cole does. She really, really does. And this whole video has been me like really talking about books and analyzing them before I even give you a description. But I feel like with this one, everybody really knows what it's about. It's a character by the name of Sydney, and she sees these companies are starting to come in and do gentrification type of things, and community members are starting to disappear, and she's having to put the pieces of the puzzle together, and she's not really sure what's happening, and she's trying to figure out what's happening. And then we have Theo appear, who Theo to me is one of those characters where I was like, you know, I wonder if he was there to serve multiple purposes. Like, Theo is that person, that white character that wants to be woke so bad that they don't realize that they're not at all, and that they still feed into the stereotypes and the other racial microaggressions that are pushed on the Black community. And I think he is one of those characters that wants to help, but is also harming without really realizing, because he wants to be so different from other white people, but he still has some aspects that make him just the same as other white people. And I think that that was an interesting discussion that was brought forward. I didn't really feel the romance between Theo and Sydney. It just, for me, it could have been one of those elements that wasn't needed. Like, they could have just been cool trying to figure out this thing together, but I don't feel like it needed to be present. Another thing that I loved about this book is that if you read it more so as horror, and for me, I think too, the reason why I saw it more so as horror, because it is horrifying for me as a Black person reading this book, because this shit really does happen. And that's what's crazy, is that this is written in a fictional setting, but this is real life. Like, this stuff really does happen. And even the final twist at the end, that's real life. Like, stuff like this really has happened to the Black community. So it's not far removed from reality. And knowing that literally I have something like this going on literally 5 minutes down the street from me is what made it so horrifying. The things that Sydney encounters with what some of the white people who are moving into the community, like things that they say to her, things that they do to her, the microaggressive behavior that happens, the racial slurs that happen, and it's just like off the top of everybody's head, like nobody's thinking twice about it. Just, she's one scene, she went into a store and a guy was insinuating like, we don't have any 40s. So you're insinuating that all Black people drink 40s or malt liquor. And it's so crazy because it happens. That is true. There are stereotypes and misconceptions placed on Black people all of the time. And the fact that this was not a historical fiction, this wasn't a realistic fiction, this was a thriller slash horror book, it really made it scary, because you know that any day that you walk out your door, shit like this really can happen, especially when gentrification is happening very, very close to the community that you live in or a community that you work in. So this book was hitting very, very close to home for me. Very, very close to home, because it's stuff that I deal with and that I work with in my profession, believe it or not, and things that I see on a daily basis. So seeing it in a horror setting just made me like, oh, holy crap. So with that being said, I ended up giving this one a 4.5 stars. Like I said, I think I would have given it full 5 stars, but that relationship between Theo and Sydney just didn't do it for me. So, but other than that, this is great. I think Alyssa Cole's phenomenal. Her writing ability is astronomical. She's gifted. She's such a gifted writer, and I can't wait to see what else she has coming forward outside of just her traditional contemporary and historical romance that she's been writing. All right, y'all, so that's it. That's 17 freaking books. 17 books that I've read so far in September. I am currently still reading a lot. There are a couple of things that I'm actually going to be working on. So I'm currently listening to Vicious by L.J. Shen. I think that's the author's name. So I'm currently listening to Vicious because I've seen a lot of people read it, and this is like an enemies to lovers romance, or a main character that, well, he's an ass, so I'm interested to see how this is going to play out. I think I'm probably only like 10% into that one. I also have another audiobook that I've been listening to that I probably will finish today, but I just was not going to include it in this wrap up. But it's Before the Ever After by Jacqueline Whitson. This is her latest book that she had coming out, and I know I talked about that a little bit. I'm probably about, yeah, I'm 75% into that one. So literally have 20 minutes left of that one, because it's such a short book that I will finish that one today. Physically, I probably will finish more of The Wicked and the Divine and pick up some more random manga. I also will be starting Tristan Strong Punches a Hole in the Sky. This is the Patreon pick for the month of September. And then I have a review that needs to go up on Instagram next week of Legendborn by Tracy Dion. I have a couple of other arcs that I need to read. So the other two arcs that I want to finish outside of the e-arcs that I have, it's going to be We Were Restless Things by Cole Nagamatsu, and then also Cobble Hill. So I will be looking at starting these within the next couple of weeks. We'll see if I finish them. These are some chunkers to finish, but I think everything's been going well. I actually have been on track. I've been finishing a book a day, essentially. That's how it's been going. I've been finishing a book a day. I've been averaging like 200 pages a day, which is really, really cool. Not something that I've been setting out to do, but it's just something that's happened, which I thought was awesome. So, all right, so that's it. If you've made it this far, let me know what book you have enjoyed so far this month, what has been your favorite book. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. If you want to see more content from me, click the subscribe button. All of the links down below to support my channel, as well as ways to follow me on social media, will be down below. And as always, I'll be back with another video soon. Bye.